Many people noticed that in the wake of, you know, a lot of outpouring of support for Asian Americans after the violence in Atlanta, lots of people were trying to show their support. One of them was Meghan McCain, and it was pointed out that it was a little bit hypocritical considering some of her past statements in this area. We talked about it last week, but I'll allow John Oliver to sum up the issue.
Just last year, many were loudly warning that Trump calling COVID names like the China virus was likely to lead to a rise in violence against people of Asian descent. An argument that at the time, not everyone seemed to find convincing.
I think if the left wants to focus on PC labeling this virus, it is a great way to get Trump reelected. I don't have a problem with people calling it whatever they want. It's a deadly virus that did originate in Wuhan. I don't have a problem with it.
Oh, good. Meghan McCain doesn't have a problem with it. Listen not to the scores of Asian Americans telling everyone that the term is dangerous and offensive. Instead, gather around and take the word of a wealthy white woman who's dressed like she's about to lay off 47 people over Zoom. Now, I will say, McCain posted this week, "Stop Asian hate" with three broken heart emojis, which is a fine sentiment to throw up on Twitter after the fact. But there has to be an understanding that saying, "I don't have a problem with calling it the China virus," is very much giving space for that hate to grow.
Yes, so a lot of people pointed out this issue. She has eventually responded to it with a tweet saying, "I condemn the reprehensible violence and vitriol that has been targeted towards the Asian American community. There is no doubt Donald Trump's racist rhetoric fueled many of these attacks, and I apologize for any past comments that aided that agenda." So progress, right? Amanda, what do you think?
All I can say is listen to the community. Listen to the community. I get it. It's really, really hard to understand in a nuanced way when you have lived with privilege your entire life. You know, and that's not to discount what actual privileged people have to go through, because everyone has their own thing. But what I'm saying is we get into this a lot with legislating, right? That like people in power who have the ability to write these laws, many of them are very well intentioned. It's not like when they write these laws, they're like malicious. However, if you don't have people at the drafting table with you who have these lived experiences, then you're gonna miss on some things. And more importantly, when people from these communities say, "Hey, that's gonna result in violence. Hey, we are afraid for our lives, for our family members' lives," listen to it. You know, I'm glad that she's apologized. At least there's that. But moving forward, I think she is an example of someone who didn't listen. So,
yeah. It's such a good point. Like, imagine if, what if I'm trying to think of like an example. Like, I don't know, Chuck Schumer started throwing around some term about the trans community or something. And imagine if we covered it on the show and I was like, "You know what? I'm okay with it. I'm good with it." What? Okay.
Yeah.
Who am I? Who am I? Like, and for McCain, it's marginally worse because, you know, look, there's lots of different forms of privilege. The fact that she's a daughter of a senator and wealthy beyond any mortal's comprehension, that is another form. I'm a man, that's a different form. But like, it's not your call.
Yeah.
How could you not know? And look, it's the same sort of job. We opine about politics. You say a lot of things that you don't necessarily know 100% about, but you should recognize when you know 0% about it and that it has nothing to do with you. It's such a weird thing, Amanda.
Oh yeah, it's weird. And it also has enabled violence. So, you know, I look at that and it's been our lived experience for so long. And I'm glad that this conversation is happening because people can learn from it. It's empathy. That's the core of this, is learning what you do know and also learning your boundaries of where your knowledge ends, right? And when you have that and you can say, "Hey, you know what? I don't know. I from my lived experience, I don't understand, but I hear you." You know, that's one way to learn, you know,
and
not to say like, "Let me just dismiss millions of people who are calling this out, even though like I haven't ever lived in your skin before. Let me just dismiss it." That's not the right
call. Exactly. I think that's a great point. And you know, there's a case could be made that her in advance, well, not in advance of all of the harassment and violence, it was almost immediate, but in advance of some of the worst violence is bad. Saying it wasn't racist after the violence, though, seems even worse. And while Fox spent days after the Atlanta shooting arguing that it's a travesty that people would imply that white supremacy has anything to do with this or racism has anything to do with this, I worry that they are going to double and triple down on this. They are looking for things they can activate their audience to hate. They found a few. They keep talking about women's sports as a way to activate their audience to hate the trans community. I don't know that they necessarily thought a year ago that trying to get people to hate Asian Americans would be their thing. But they want people mad about the pandemic, and they found a scapegoat that clearly a lot of racists find to be very appealing. So God only knows where they're gonna turn to on this topic in the future, when and if almost certainly more violence continues to happen.
Yeah, and they're gonna get a lot of help from the structural things at play that have made us a scapegoat for literally the entire existence of when Asian Americans have stepped onto this country. You know, yeah. That's a very old playbook that they're stepping into.
100%.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.